a water pipe. The meeting of the Board of Selectmen, we didn't have the 48 hours to post, and weren't able to do a few other things because of what happened last night at Town Hall, which has messed up our schedule. Our agenda will be an abbreviated one, and we will jump around a little bit as we try to accommodate all kinds of moving parts. With that, I'm going to ask Mr. Kamala to give us a quick 5-minute overview of what happened in Town Hall, what's his current status, and what's the plan moving forward for the day-to-day operations of our local government, and then we'll get into the agenda. So this is the first emergency item, Mr. Kamala.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I think the best way of giving this update to the board and to the community is to thank Community Hopkinton, and here's why. We have to thank Community Hopkinton for its vision, oversight, and generosity in funding the following projects at Town Hall: digitizing our records, upgrading the fire alarm system, centralization of the files in the basement following the basement drainage system project, as well as the investments that the community has made in terms of our IT infrastructure, communications, and software programs. Combined, all of these made it possible for us to respond quickly, timely, and effectively to what happened at Town Hall. What happened at Town Hall is there was a failure of a gasket on a 3-inch valve located on the third floor. As a result of that, my estimates, and these are based on information I received from the facilities as well as fire departments, is that we lost over 1,000 gallons of water, which then went through the building, coming up from the third floor all the way down to the basement. The response, again, going back to what the community has done to put us in a stronger position to respond to such incidents, was fabulous. The fire department, facilities department, police department, building inspector responded promptly and collaborated on their efforts. They shut off the system immediately to secure community assets and to make sure that everybody was safe, everybody at Town Hall was safe. They also immediately shop vacuumed all standing water in the building, shut out the water systems, though making sure that we were still safe. They also covered most of the electronic equipment in our offices. The facilities department also immediately brought on site the remediation team. The remediation crews were on site within 1.5 hours. Here's what they did. They coordinated the recovery management, including water extraction, installing dehumidifiers, as well as bringing in large fans to blow most of the water away, removal of safety hazards, including ceiling tiles that were falling off from the ceiling. They also addressed all the immediate needs with regard to the electrical equipment at Town Hall. Suffice to say, thanks to the foresight of the community as well as the IT department, our IT network is safe and it's operating in full capacity. They also, through the efforts of the facilities department, we were also able to bring in a hygienist. The hygienist is the person who's responsible for collecting all samples for materials that could be hazardous to the safety of the people using Town Hall, including employees as well as residents. For example, they are testing for asbestos. They also ran samples relative to the joint compounds in the building, insulation on pipes, as well as the glue that is used on the tiles in the building. We also were able to bring an electrician on site who was able to shut off the electricity, though making sure that wherever the electricity was needed, especially for our server systems, that we were able to do so. We were also fortunate enough, and again, thanks to the generosity of the community, we were able to stage facilities personnel 24 hours to safeguard the community's assets. Thanks to Dave, Steve, and Mike, they were able to do that. And through the leadership of our fire chief, we immediately called a meeting of the Hopkinton Emergency Management Group. Here's what we accomplished through that meeting. Number one, we immediately started setting up our incident command management system and team. Number two, we immediately identified specific times that we should be meeting to update each other, share information, and most importantly, update the community. And then thirdly, we also identified measures that we need to take to make sure that we quickly go back to providing the essential services that we do to the community. Here's how we're going to do that. We're going to relocate town hall staff in the following manner. The Land Use Department, Inspection Services, Board of Health, as well as the administrative support team in the town manager's office will move to the fire department. The finance team, including finance, accounting, treasurer, as well as assessors, will move to the senior center. They will also be joined by the youth and family services department. HR, through the generosity and collaboration of the school superintendent and the school committee, I should say, we are able to move the HR department to school administration. And finally, your town clerk will be relocated to the police department. In all of this, I really need to express my gratitude one more time to the community for its vision, for its foresight, and for its generosity. I also want to thank our public safety team. The response yesterday was excellent. They were on site promptly. They were very quick in their implementation of strategies to protect the community assets. And finally, facilities. Dave, I don't know how you do it, but thank you again. And at this point, I'll take questions from the board.
So, Mr. Kamalo, what is the timeline? You may have mentioned this. What is the timeline, or how long do you think that the town hall is going to be out of service, if you had to guess?
Yes. Our goal is to have town hall services available to the public by tomorrow afternoon.
But how long will town hall be out of commission?
Oh, you mean the building per se?
Yes.
The preliminary estimates are that the work that needs to be done will have to be done in the next 2.5 to 3 months.
Okay, so 2.5 to 3 months. We're going to split everybody up. We're going to go to the various places that Mr. Kamalo mentioned. The services will be available there to all the citizens, but we have to educate them as to where they have to go. So we need to make sure we get signage on town hall that says where you need to go, and obviously we need to get it out to the media, so we should probably work on some form of communication or some form of and other things too to accomplish that. Okay?
Yes.
Make sense?
Yes. Thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Kamalo?
Yes. Mrs. Wright.
Mr. Kamalo, you did not mention where the town manager and the Board of Selectmen will be accommodated.
Well, they did all this to get us out of the building,
exactly.
So we don't have anywhere to go.
You've got to be somewhere. You left yourself out.
Yes. Elaine and I will be roving between the senior center and the fire department. The police chief has also said we're welcome at the station. However, our goal is to make sure that at least two of us are at the fire station. That will be Maria being at the front desk to attend to the calls or inquiries coming to the office, and either Elaine or myself will be at the fire station to assist you at any one time.
So Maria at the fire station.
Yes.
Who's going to be in the Prius?
Dave.
Okay, so let's stay with Mrs. Wright, too. She's wrapped up.
All right, that's fine.
You good?
Yep.
Mr. Sestari, anything?
Okay, so if you have to see the town clerk, you go to the police department. If you have to go to the library, you go to South Street. If you have to go...
Yes.
We have a temporary town right now, it seems. Thanks for working on this. I want to add one more thanks, and that, I think you did mention it in the middle of everything, was to the school committee and the school department for giving us this facility on short notice, and I'm assuming for the next couple months, I'm hoping for the next couple months. And, you know, I think we realize that we may have to adjust our schedule as well to accommodate things that are already booked here, but we appreciate that. I'd like to propose something to the rest of the board, and I'm hoping that Mr. Kamala will be amenable to this, but I would think that the board might want to assign a member as, you know, more or less a liaison to help Mr. Kamala with this project, especially getting it off the ground over the next 3 to 4 weeks, and, you know, just kind of helping line things up, giving suggestions and things of that nature, just kind of giving support and insights as they go along.
I think the communication of this is really important. I mean, to your point about the schools, last night at 7 o'clock, we were all sitting outside town hall trying to figure out what we were going to do. And I called Dr. McLeod, Kathy McLeod, and she answered the phone. And within 5 minutes, she called me back and said, you can go to the high school tomorrow night. We'll get it all sorted out. You know, they've been great. But we need to have a lot of communication, not only internally in town hall or the town hall staff, but externally to the community. So I like the idea of somebody sort of a community representative as part of this process that can sing the song about what we're doing, because it's going to be very, for a lot of people that depend on town hall on a regular basis, this is going to be very disruptive. So I think we have to be sensitive to that, and I think we should give them an elected official to...
Well, I'm in town all day. I'm only at Golden Pond all day long. So
I hear one person stepping forward.
So I'm right on Main Street.
Well, and given, you know, honestly, I was thinking of you anyway, because just because of your background falls in line. I do this to do something different from the rest of my day.
And you have a construction supervisor's license, don't you?
Yes, I do.
Okay. All right, so... any other questions? We'll come back to your suggestion here in a minute. Mrs. Wright, Mr. Pitino, questions?
Please. Yeah, I just had one. I didn't hear. The town clerk is at the police station?
Police station.
Okay, good. Because that's one of the, you know, most of the people, many of the people that come into town hall are coming to see the town clerk. So I just wanted to make sure that people got hold of that one.
Does the movement of the employees cause any individual hardships for any of the employees who were in a certain space or worked in a certain office where there was accommodations for them for whatever reason? I don't know, but I'm just wondering, have we considered all that? Is anybody concerned about where they're going?
At this point, we have not identified any constraints pertaining to the information that we may already have in the HR department. So we have not identified any constraints. We have a meeting that is scheduled with staff tomorrow at 8 a.m., so the emergency management group will be meeting with staff, and if there are any other concerns we need to be aware of, we will take advantage of that meeting.
I think you should just make that available to them if anybody wants to come to you in private and talk for whatever reason, because there's a lot of different things that people might be thinking through, and give them a chance to air those concerns as well.
Yeah, Mr. Chair.
I've seen that in my previous management world. Yes.
I was wondering, what about... you know, now all these other buildings, and now they have an influx of people. What about parking?
Yes. In terms of the fire department, I will be speaking with Crosspoint mm-hmm. to see if they could accommodate our parking needs temporarily. The senior center, we took into account the fact that recently the town invested money in an additional parking lot as you're coming into the senior center. So we'll be asking town hall employees as well as residents visiting town hall offices at the senior center to use that parking lot. Police station, hopefully Dave will hurry up and build the 6 new parking spaces.
And does the closure of the building cause us to have to move anything for the marathon on Monday? You know, were we allowing any elite runners or, you know, diplomats or anything like that use of the building that we have to change now?
Yes, there's a group that will be using the basement of Town Hall. Dave is looking into that, and we should have an answer before Monday.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
That group would like to know before Monday
where
they're going on Monday, just FYI.
Yeah.
Runners are very, very nervous about these things.
Yeah.
If we can accommodate them, we should try, but wait until Monday morning and saying it's where you're going will cause a great deal of anxiety.
Yep.
Okay. Mr. Tisdon.
Oh, the only other question that I have is where all the meetings are going to be. So our meetings, planning board, you know, all these meetings that we're having, are they going to be meeting specific, or will we say we're going to meet here, or they're going to meet there?
We're going back to our meeting schedule and looking at possibly, I think as Brian said, continuing to have the Board of Selectmen meetings here, accommodating the planning board meetings perhaps at HCAM.
Mm-hmm.
Jim, that's our request. And thirdly, we also, I think, have the support from Cindy Chesmore to open up the Senior Center for evening meetings.
Yeah, I think for each individual board, the chairs will try and sort out schedules and where they can meet. All meetings have to be in a public building. All meetings have to be fully accessible, so we'll figure all that out. We may think about going to HCAM as well for some of these because it's a room that can seat as many people as are here this evening, and it's obviously easy for them, so we might do that as well. We'll see. We'll figure that out because I'm sure the schools have lots of things planned for Tuesday nights between now and the end of the year, and who knows what else is going on.
Yep.
So we're still kind of in figure-it-out mode,
but
that's a good question. The meetings have to go on.
And then also just one point is to Norman and the chiefs and everyone involved, it's nice to see when something like that happens how quick our resources are mobilized and how well everybody meshes together and works together. So it's not unexpected, but it's nice to see. So thank you to everyone involved.
Josh Grosetti in his IT office, where will they be accommodated?
Josh has accepted working from a mobile office. He's going to be moving from building to building.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Any other thoughts, questions, concerns about Town Hall and the extended vacation we're going to take from that building until we get it sorted out?
Yeah.
Everybody good? You good, Mr. Kamala?
Yes. In fact, I thought the board was going to ask about funding. I can tell you, again, thanks to the efficient response from our facilities department, Maya, our insurance provider, was already on site today. They are compiling a preliminary report that will then be lined up with our expectations to be developed by Dave, Chuck, as well as the fire inspections team.
Good. Good work.
Okay, more to come, folks, and we'll certainly get some information out. And I want to tackle this question or this idea that Mr. Sestari raised specific to assigning one of us to be a liaison to the Town Hall repairs group or the emergency management group, specific to having someone from our group or our board on that and involved in that discussion and communicating with the residents what's going on with that. I heard Mr. Catino step forward. Is anybody else interested in doing that work?
I am interested in Mr. Catino doing that work.
You're interested in Mr. Catino doing that work. Okay. Mr. Catino, are you interested and would you be willing to do that?
Absolutely.
Okay. So I think that a lot of that will go to you and maybe just a little bit of communication or coordination with the chair on some of it, but most of it should be with you, right? So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to appoint Mr. Catino to serve as a liaison to the fire or town hall restoration or whatever we're calling it, committee or team.
Reparation.
Yeah. So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on the table. Mr. Kamal, are you good with that motion?
Yes.
You're good with the idea of having someone kind of there from the elected board to kind of help out without getting in the way?
Yes, I would have been disappointed had it been somebody else other than Mr. Cortino.
I take that personally. Thank you for that.
You just saw where the votes were going. And then you all those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, Mr. Catino, thank you for stepping forward.
Gotcha.
Okay, and continuing with this sort of emergency session here, the Board of Selectmen, we're out of order, and I apologize, and the agenda will continue to be for a little bit here. Is there anyone here this evening from the public that would like to address the board for any reason? Feel free. Okay, so any note takers? Item two is done. Before we go to item three, I see there's several visitors here tonight or folks with us. So what we're planning on tackling here in the next little bit is an update on the budget, okay? And then we're going to do a couple of staff appointments. We're going to look at the consent agenda and do some proclamations. I think we're going to pass on the planning process for 192 Hayden Row. We're going to pass on the public hearing for the street acceptance. That's not going to happen tonight. We're going to talk about the annual town warrant. I don't think we're going to get into individual articles, though. I think we're going to, for the most part, just decide whether or not we want to sign the town warrant. And then the annual town meeting warrant. No, that's part of that. That's what I just covered. And that will be about it. So if you're not here for one of those reasons, I just want to let you know that you're welcome to stay. But if you're here for a specific reason other than what I just talked about, if you want to raise your hand and ask, if you have any questions, everybody okay with that? Okay, good.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Kamal.
With your permission, I think there's also one other item.
Okay.
The appointment of Erin Killen as the HR generalist.
Where is that in here? Number three. That was a staff appointment.
Yeah,
I mentioned that.
Exactly. Okay.
So yeah, we can do that. Yeah. Okay. All right, so everybody's good. I just don't want to waste anybody's time, that's all. Okay, so with that,
Mr. Chair,
Mr. Sestari,
are we going off the agenda that has us adjourning at 8:30 or the one that has us adjourning at 9:30?
We have the one that's adjourning at about 7:30.
Excellent.
So moved.
Hint, hint. Okay, Mr. Kamal, a budget update. And we have Mrs. Nickerson here from the school committee. I see a couple folks here from the appropriations committee. Mr. Westerling, Chief Salmon, Chief Lee was here. Town clerk was here. If anybody has any questions as we get into the budget update, now would be the time to ask them. And I'm going to be interested in hearing from the school committee for a couple minutes about where they are in this process. But with that, I'll turn it over to Mr. Kamal.
Yes.
So we're on to the budget update.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would like to refer you to the budget information that we just shared with you tonight. It's the document entitled Town of Hopkinton Town Manager's FY18 Financial Model Budget and Capital Plan. And specifically draw your attention to pages 1 and 2. At the time the Board of Selectmen forwarded the FY18 comprehensive budget to the Appropriations Committee, there was an understanding and a request by the Board of Selectmen that we continue to look into opportunities of bringing the overall tax impact down to 3%. You will see that if you look at page 1, the bottom part where we outline the tax levy increase, the tax impact, net of new growth, the number under column 3, FY2018, is now 3%. How do we get to that number? I then refer you to page 2. At the time the Board of Selectmen forwarded the FY18 budget to the Appropriations Committee, the tax levy back then, February 28th, was $62,554,609.10. Here is what has changed. On the increase side, in terms of expenses, the veterans assessment is up approximately $647. KIF assessment is up approximately $121,000. The transfer to stabilization, we're proposing to increase it by $200,000, which brings a total increase to the levy of $322,549.57. On the revenue side, we are proposing that we increase the free cash use by $50,000. In addition, while also referencing the recommendations of the school committee to remove some articles that they had proposed that were supposed to be funded by free cash in the amount of $116,000. We also account, as we discussed before, the $110,000 that was double counted in the school articles. We've also looked at old articles that were suggesting that we repurpose the funding in the amount of $264,406,000. And as you noticed, our free cash is now certified. Back in February, we were projecting certified free cash to be at 1.5. It came greater than that by an additional $287,873. So the decreases, the total decreases to the levy amount to $828,279. And if you take out the additional increase of 322, the net change to the levy is $505,729.43, which therefore brings us to a new tax levy of $62,048.879.67. And that brings us down to an overall tax impact net of new growth of 3%. So in summary, this is how we got to the 3%, and these are the major changes that have occurred in the budget. One other thing I should mention, too, is our snow and ice deficit. Because of the fact that we certified free cash at greater than the number that we proposed, and also the fact that we are repurposing some of the old capital articles, we are proposing that we fund the approximately $500,000 deficit in snow and ice in FY17. Free cash is now certified. We pay for it in FY17.
And that's done at with an article at town meeting, or how's that done? Or is that because it's snow and ice we can do it?
That would be part of the budget, I believe, budget article.
Okay. Yeah. All right, so when we last talked about the budget formally, we sent it off to the Appropriations Committee. We sent it off with the request that the town manager continue to do his work and his team and all the various department heads across the community to do their work to set a goal, and we set a goal of working towards a 3% net of new growth tax impact. So he's coming back tonight and showing us how he can calculate 3% net of new growth tax impact. Part of that, and we have a couple guests here, and that's why I want to get to them first before we go down our path a little bit. And we don't have to finalize this tonight, correct? Because it really hasn't even come back from the Appropriations Committee. They're still doing their work as well. Are you guys done?
In fact, most of this information is relatively new, and thus we want to continue to have the conversations with the Appropriations Committee. And then when we are in a position to formally adjust the budget, we will come back to the Board of Selectmen.
Okay, so we're just getting an update here, but I want to give our guests a chance to comment if any of them have any thoughts about this. And I'd like to start with the school committee first, Mrs. Nickerson. Mrs. Nickerson, whatever you're comfortable doing, there's a mic here, so it'd probably be better, yeah.
Hello.
Hi. So what do you think?
So I don't have all those numbers in front of me. I have what we made decisions on Thursday. But I know they were coming out of different areas. So the numbers didn't necessarily jive with what we had added up for us. Like, I thought it had been more. But at the same time, I think it's because of where it's coming out of, and that's, I don't want to mess all that up. So, I can speak to the first thing I did want to say is that you're more than welcome to have use of this library or any of the open spaces in the middle school and the high school are certainly probably the most appropriate for your meetings and other town meetings. But just to let you know, this library, the library in the middle school, there's a lecture hall. once school is out, too, all of those things become very empty, but in the next few months, they will decrease in activity as well. And they're all air-conditioned, so that helps for the summer.
Excellent.
So the school committee, I would say the conversation on Thursday was difficult. It was not unanimous by any stretch of the imagination. I think that there's still concern that we're setting ourselves up for some difficult times next year. But I am very confident in the fact that every decision that was made in regard to the capital articles that are being put forward this year all are absolutely in the needs of the education program versus the wants. I think the one item that I would bring to everyone's attention that did not get put forward was the middle school auditorium air conditioning. And that was one of the votes that was 3-2. And there was an argument about that from the standpoint of it was put before a town meeting last year, it was approved, the numbers didn't match up with what the engineering came back with this year, we should put it before the town meeting again. My argument against that was I didn't feel that I could get up on town floor and make a viable argument as to how that would help the education of the kids versus other needs. We did not touch the operating budget for very specific reasons of there being significant special education needs this coming year, especially with students that are coming to town that English is not their first language. And we had a significant conversation with appropriation about that piece in addition to just our special ed budget overall. So I'm confident with the changes that we've made, but I think there were a couple of very good points made. Like one of the issues that we did take off was the paving of the loop road, which may actually get some flack because it's in rather dire straits. But the conversation came from the fact that if we do end up moving forward with the turf field next year, there'll be a lot of heavy equipment on that road, and we don't want to destroy it after we just fixed it. And it's not in such dire straits at this point that a year would make all that much of a difference, so we figured that would be better pushed off. So those are some of the decisions that were made. In addition to the facility shed that was taken off because of the fact that we don't know what the Irvine Todaro Committee is going to do yet with that land, and we didn't have a place for it. So I think everything was very thoughtfully played out between the group. I just think that there was concern that we're not going to have a better time trying to get some of these issues next year. But we kept intact the technology needs of the students based on the fact that a lot of our standardized testing is going to be going electronic in the very near future and needing wireless access in our buildings for that reason. All of the security upgrades were very important, obviously, and those two programs specifically were supposed to be 3-year, and they've already moved to 5, so we weren't comfortable extending that. But unless you had any other specific questions, I would say that's pretty much the overview from Thursday night.
So the last time we gathered, since the last time we gathered, between what you folks have done at the school committee and what the town manager and the finance director for the town and Kathy and Ralph for the schools, everybody got together, and the number difference is
$226,000. $262,000.
So you guys came up with $262,000. Where's the $262,000 here? I see 226.
Yeah, I think Mrs. Nickerson hit the nail on the head. What you see in front of you expresses the numbers in terms of funding sources and how we get to balance the budget.
Got it.
If you want the comprehensive list of what was removed from the school.
I can list that if you'd like.
Yes.
So there was $25,000 for the Elmwood School receiving door. And based on the timing of when we put that in, which was November, and you don't ever want to hit your emergency facilities fund at that time in case a boiler goes in the middle of the winter. We're now in April. We had that funding for this year left, so we decided that we're just going to pay for the door now and get it taken care of. So that was $25,000. We removed $30,000 from the technology ask in that warrant article due to the fact that it was specific to the sound system in the auditorium of the high school and that we felt like we could continue on with the sound system that's in there at this time. The rest of the technology upgrades were all in relation to wireless access at the middle school in Elmwood, and we kept those. We removed the air conditioning ask for the auditorium in the middle school, which will be much to the chagrin of town meeting if it's 80 degrees that day, but we'll have to deal with that as it comes. And I believe it's 30, 25, 25. And then the facility shed, that was the other one. So my addition was 85 and 162. I might actually be off, Mr. Kamalo, but it might have been 242.
There's the list right there.
Okay.
At the bottom.
But your committee voted those items, and while no one's perfectly comfortable and we all don't get everything we want in this process,
right,
you're okay. They're okay.
Yes. I mean, the committee, the majority approved that on Thursday, and I believe it was all submitted to Mr. Kamalo and Mr. Sandini on Friday.
Okay, great. So with that, thank you.
Sure.
Are we okay from getting for school input now?
Yes, I believe, again,
for now.
For now, as we learn new information, we'll continue to share it with the school committee and the school superintendent. I think we're all set for now.
Everybody's good. Okay.
Yeah. Yes. Just one thing, Mrs. Nixon, really, thank you very much. I was one that pushed the 3%, and I know that it was tough to make all those decisions, but it really is wonderful. Thanks, and thank the committee, because it really, really did help bring all the numbers down, and I commend you on bringing the committee together as a chairman. Thank
Great.
You very much.
Thank you. I do have one question, and it may not be appropriate here, and if not, then feel free to direct me to another time, Mr. Kamal and Mr. Chair, but the committee this year really felt it was important to provide more insight to the taxpayers on the warrant articles themselves, because in past years we've definitely stumbled at some of the meetings, and it was vital to me that the presentation be very crisp and clear to the taxpayers so that there's not a lot of questions that should be actually relatively evident. And not that people shouldn't be asking questions, but I feel like they should have enough information where the basic questions are answered. So the committee actually decided this year we were going to create basically like FAQs for each of our warrant articles. And our question is, how do we best disseminate that at town meeting, like the other documentation that's done? Because we've never done it before.
If I may, suggestion would be we will post the motions for town meeting,
mm-hmm.
and for each motion, we will link it to the FAQs that you may have developed. So that information is in one location.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay,
so
perfect.
People read the article, the motion, and here's the background information.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Then we'll be in touch on those. We've already started drafting. We should be finalizing them at our meeting this week and be well prepared ahead of town meeting so that information is available to all the citizens ahead of time. So.
Okay.
Great. All right.
Thank you for coming.
Oh, did I say? Sorry.
Thank you for coming.
This one. Thank you very much.
We're headed in the right direction. Okay. Any other guests here this evening want to comment, ask questions, or share concerns about the budget update that we received? Yes, sir. Mr. Manning. Yeah, it's probably better. So we have the member of the Appropriations Committee. Are you the chair? Who's the chair? Mike's the chair. The chair's going to join us for a minute. Mike Manning, welcome.
Thank you. So although we're not ready to, we haven't deliberated yet, we are still waiting for your blessing on the budget and forwarding it to us. But we also wanted to take the opportunity. I mean, we absolutely appreciate, we've been running through this effort for a couple of months now trying to get the budget down. So it has been a real challenge to get it down to 3%. I think it was a month and a half ago or whatever when I said I thought it was going to be a 6 or 7% increase year over year. And the fact that we're able to approach, that's why I was happy with 3.7% because it was very, I thought that was good enough, but we got it down to 3%. But I just wanted to highlight, or just while you discuss, a couple of, it's not really concerns, but something, parts of it you should be aware of, the assumptions that were made to get it to 3%. One is the extensive use of free cash. And I thought it was definitely outside of the box, finding creative ways to use the free cash. We took, you know, whether it was in the school budget, we thought, hey, here's a one-time expense for textbooks or certain things that are just a one-time expense. It would be great just to use the free cash for that because it's not in the it's not the position, it's not the employees that we're digging into. It's beyond that. Mm-hmm. One thing, you know, the use of the free cash that did concern us, to get down to 3%, we did apply a certain amount to items that are really year over year. Such items, you know, it's around $300,000 or $400,000, but it could be leases for the IT. The schools had like $300,000 or $400,000 in leases. So these are going to be year over year, and we're using it for free cash. And that's the major example, which couple of, you know, I always say don't use free cash if we're going to need it year over year. So, but that was one of the efforts to get it down to 3%. What are the risks? We don't have free cash next year. We're going to have to use go into the tax levy, you know, to tax that. So just keep that in mind. But that was the extra effort to get it down to 3%. Another one of the items was essentially we are more aggressive this year. I think one of the complaints year over year from the Board of Selectmen is that we always have so much free cash at the end of the year because the finance department is rather conservative on estimates. How do we know exactly what the new growth is going to be? In the past year, they were like, okay, it's 1.2 million increase, and that's with legacy farms up to 1.5. This year, we're up to 2.1, which is it's in line with what it was last year, but it's definitely more aggressive. So are we going to have that kind of growth next year or not? But it could mean we won't have as much free cash. Same thing with local receipts. Maybe a lot of people are buying new cars or whatever the reasons. That's the excise tax. We have the receipts. The assumption is I think we raised that amount almost $1 million this year in the assumptions, and it could be right. That's where we'll be. But the risk is that we won't have as much free cash, so it's not as conservative. So essentially, this is just something to keep in mind. And the third thing is, you know, we took on a lot of new debt, obviously the three big projects. And one thing that is new, and I don't disagree with the method, that instead of doing two 20-year borrowings, we did, I believe, 30-year, which is kind of new. Maureen Dwinnell, she refused to accept anything over a 20-year borrowing. And this year, just because it definitely makes sense in the appropriations opinion, you know, for the DPW, the library, these are one-time things that should hopefully will have a 50-year life. So let's spread it over. The school, excuse me, the school, maybe not so much because this. If I'm not sure, 100% sure if that is 30-year, all of it will be 30-year. But the fact all the schools have always been 20 years because there's always another renovation. There's always something coming every few years for the school. So the fact that this is 30 years. Means we're going to be that's a long time considering already on the list is the Elmwood School renovation, maybe the middle school's coming. You know, 30 years is a long time. Something to consider. Is this wrong? It's up to you to know, but this is something that should be noted. That's how we got what could have been 6 or 7%. It helped get it down to 3%. So I'm not the appropriations committee did not necessarily say this is a bad idea, but when you get to these numbers, this is the flexibility that we took into account to get to that number. So anyway, I just wanted to bring that up, and it was definitely something we're discussing, but it is terrific that we were able to get the number down.
Great. Thank you. Excellent points.
Thank you.
Well said. Are we done with the budget discussion for now or the update?
I believe we're done with the budget unless, with your permission, if Mr. Sandini has any additional comments, but otherwise I think we're done.
Okay. So just to be clear, though, the Board of Selectmen a while back, 6 weeks ago I think or so now, we did vote to pass the budget to Appropriations Committee, correct? Mr. Kamal?
Yes, with a qualifying statement. And the effort described tonight is towards that qualifying statement.
Right. So, but the Appropriations Committee has the budget, and they've been massaging the budget and investigating it, and they've had various groups come in. Have you had the public hearing yet?
It was supposed to be tonight, but we lost
our... To the emergency meeting discussion, yes, I understand. Okay, so that's ongoing, but you have the budget, like, from us, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So I thought I'd
I misheard something there. Okay. So with that, we're going to move off the budget discussion.
It was just the idea. It wasn't the budget. You were passing us the budget with the idea that you wanted a certain amount cut from it to bring it down to a certain level. So is that really what you're passing to us, or if you vote tonight, is this the budget that you want?
We're not voting anything tonight on the budget. Okay? We're moving in the direction of getting the budget to where we want it to be. But you have a budget from us that you are going through. Correct?
Yes.
So we do have to vote on approving a budget.
You do, and sending it back.
This is the selectman's budget. You want to make sure this is the budget you want.
Right.
Yes, we'll do that.
Okay, so Mr. Kamal, you're going to get with them on that, right?
Yes, we will.
Okay, Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, I just thought that our board was going to have an opportunity to ask questions and make comments as well.
So we're not really getting into a whole big budget discussion tonight because this is an emergency meeting, and we want to get an update as to where we are.
Okay.
But if we go too far down a path, then we're going to get outside the emergency meeting rules. So if it depends on how deep you want to go.
I think if we can have other boards come up and make comments on an item, then we can make comments as well.
What is your comment?
You know, I think that this is very deceiving, this budget. I do want to thank the school committee for reducing their proposed spending. We don't seem to have cut anything on our spending. I'm looking at this, and the money that we're, you know, saving the taxpayers is basically coming out of different savings accounts and couch cushions. You know, old capital articles, money that's being repurposed, $265,000. Increase in free cash use over the estimated $287,000. Those come to $552,000 that we're, I'm glad that we're not taxing the taxpayers again, but it's money that we had, and, you know, we really didn't cut any spending. So, you know, it's, I don't want to say deceiving because I know it's a lot of hard effort on the part of Norman and Mr. Sandini, but you know, I just want to be real about this too. And I guess my hope is that when we get these budgets to begin with, that we're going to know the money from old capital articles that's being repurposed and we can apply to the budget, mm-hmm. and that we have visibility into how much we should be using from free cash. So I guess that's my main beef with this. Again, when we met 6 weeks ago and we were talking about getting this down to a 3% increase for the taxpayers, you know, I wasn't sure if we would make it or not. All I wanted was a good, solid effort, and I think that, you know, we did get that. And, again, I want to thank the school committee for their efforts as well. But it was more of a shifting of money on our side as opposed to a cutting of any costs.
Mr. Kamal.
Through the chair, Mr. Sestari, I think you make a very good point. That's exactly what happened. yeah, that's what happened. And
at least we agree.
Exactly. I'm now looking at the discussion regarding cutting spending as a long-term discussion.
Mm-hmm.
I think going forward, now that we have the town will have more flexibility in drawing up the budget calendar. I think part of drawing up the budget calendar would be giving the Board of Selectmen and other stakeholders the opportunity to define the level of spending that will be allowed in the coming fiscal year. And we, from our perspective, we're not able to do that now. We realize that. We also acknowledge the fact that a great deal of effort had gone into preparing the budgets, and there were preliminary cuts made then. And when the opportunity came up to repurpose some of the free cash money, we chose that way. But I do agree with you that the goal of cutting spending was not met in FY18.
So just a very quick follow-up so that we can, so we don't go too deep on this and we can move on. The old capital articles money that's being repurposed, is there any more? Are we only using a portion of it? or are we using all of the money that we found that can be repurposed?
In this instance, I believe, Ms. Sandini, feel free to jump in as well. I believe we're using all the money that we found this year.
And then the with the additional free cash that's being used over the original estimate, where does that put us for free cash as a you know, as a solid number and as a percentage of budget?
Oh, as a solid number for this year, we were certified at, what's the number, 1.783? Yeah, 2.7. Mm-hmm. Approximately 2.7 million. And as a percentage of the budget, are you asking as a percentage of the operating budget in,
yeah.
In FY17 or FY18?
Let's go FY18.
I'm looking to
what number do you have?
Yeah.
Are we up? So, I mean, we're around 5%, right? 4 or 5%.
Oh, if you're looking, if you're counting free cash combined with our stabilization fund, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
You know what? And that's a good point.
Yes.
I'm looking in the wrong pocket there. I was concerned more with stabilization too.
3.3.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions on the update?
I'm all set.
All good?
Good.
Is that it? Mr. Kamal, are you good?
We're good.
We're coming back to budget again before town meeting, but just want to get the update, okay? All right, with that, we're going to close that agenda item and move ahead. Next up. We have our HR director and I believe a guest, perhaps soon to be or is, actually is, new employee with us. Maria, you want to join us? Right over here, please. This is an affirmative vote to appoint.
I'm feeling like Ed McMahon over here. I get all the guests over next to me.
Yes.
Welcome, Maria.
Good evening.
Welcome, Aaron.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Maria, please.
Yes, so I would like to present Aaron Mulcahy for your affirmative vote for the HR generalist position that Jessica Leverance had. So it's not a new position. We're filling the position that she vacated. For those who in the community who knew her, she accepted a position with the town of Charlton as their HR director. So we're pretty happy for her. And then I'd like to present Erin. Erin comes with a diverse background. She does have, 5.5, 6 years municipal experience. The way Concord is structured is quite a bit of the HR part is done in the finance department. So she was responsible for that. In particular, she's got quite a bit of expertise with regard to retirees and benefits. The Medicare system is quite complex, coupled with our MedEx complement program for our 350-ish retirees, and Erin has that experience, as well as she's got a, in her prior company, she's got kind of a program information analyst background, and I see her bringing great value to the town as we're looking to electronicize, is that a word? As much as we can, not only records-wise, but for the HRIS system. We're looking to do the ESS. And so Erin will bring great value there to help us bring into the electronic age.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Erin, hello.
Hi.
How are you?
Thanks for having me tonight.
Welcome to the high school.
Thank you very much.
This is your new town hall.
Beautiful, I know.
We're a little out of sorts here tonight, and we are in this emergency mode where we're just doing time-sensitive issues on the agenda that was scheduled for last night. Right. And so this is somewhat time sensitive in that you're here.
Thank
and
you.
We want to get the affirmative vote done. So welcome. You want us to take a minute and just introduce yourself?
So my name is Erin Mulcahy. I presently am at the Town of Concord. I am the finance assistant. I've had the pleasure of being there for 6 years. We just welcomed a new finance director about 7 months ago, and she's doing wonderfully. She's given me some new opportunities where I've been able to integrate my municipal HR experience with my background, which was coming from a technical background where I worked sort of with an insurance at the, it was, the name of the company was EDS, bought out by HP, and sort of how that goes. But in any event, it was with the Blue Cross Blue Shield account, so I had the technical insurance experience. And now we've been turning our HRIS system into a electronic e-time system, time and attendance. So I've been able to marry the HR municipal experience and my technical experience by being the project lead for this project for the town. I think that's really the most that I have to bring. Plus, I love to work with people. I'm rule-oriented. I'm a quick learner. I work hard. And I'm dedicated to working as hard as I possibly can and learning something every day.
Great. And you folks are going to the administration, school administration building.
Correct. We'll be over at the school administration building.
And do you have an office there? Do you have a private office?
I think I'll learn at 8 a.m. tomorrow. So I apologize for my...
You're moving.
My gear, yes. I have already been packing up boxes and whatnot, so...
Okay, great. And Erin, what's the start date?
May 1st, potentially.
Okay. I may have missed that, sorry. Great. Well, thank you for joining the team. We're excited to have you. I know Maria thinks highly of you, or you wouldn't be sitting here. And you got some big shoes to fill there with Jessica, but I think this is going to be a great opportunity for you and for the town of Hockington. So welcome.
Thank you.
And with that, I'll turn it over to my colleagues, Mr. Tedstone.
Well, welcome aboard.
Thank you.
We're glad that you saw fit to apply here and to go through the process. And now that you came out on top, I think you're going to find a pretty dynamic community that we have here. And glad to have you part of it. And help keeping us moving forward.
Thank you.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, welcome. Thank you very much for coming. You're coming from another great town.
Yes.
You know, Lexington, Concord are where it all began, and we are where it all begins.
Right.
So it's very similar. But thank you very much for coming. Thank you for bringing some new expertise.
That's one of the smoothest transitions he's ever done.
What? No, it's really appreciated. And sorry that you're not going to be able to jump right into the former office that was there, but hopefully we'll get it together and we'll be even better with Mr. Kamalo and the group. But thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Town Hall, great again.
Well, welcome on board. You have some impressive experience, particularly in the town of Concord, so I think we're very fortunate to have you join our team, and we hope you'll enjoy working for Hockington. Really pleased to welcome you, Erin.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, welcome aboard and good luck.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, the chair will entertain a motion to affirmatively vote to support the hiring of Erin Mulcahy as the town's human resources generalist.
So moved.
Second.
So a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. All set.
Thank you for coming tonight. Thank you.
Appreciate your flexibility. Okay, we're going to pass on the minutes. They're not time sensitive. The proclamations are, and that there's a celebration coming up soon. Mr. Kamal.
I'm requesting that the board approve the proclamations in the event that should they be needed for specific events by the recipients. However, we will still ask the board to have the big public celebration with the scouts organizations.
Right. Okay. So typically we go through it, they come in and explain and all that, but given the timing and all the other stuff. But we would like to have the proclamations done so they can have them at their ceremony if they're coming up in due course. So with that, Chair will entertain a motion to approve the proclamations for the Eagle Scouts, Andrew Palaco, Tristan Clark, Austin Odell of Boy Scout Troop Number 4.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So we'll get those proclamations done, and we'll get them out to the young men and their troop leader. The resignation, why don't we tackle this, because it'll be a spot that's open and we can start working on that in terms of, that doesn't impact, no, that's appointed. Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to accept the resignation of Marcus Waldron as a member of the Conservation Commission. The term expires June 30th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? We'll probably just hold and fill that after the election's over. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So unanimously so carries. We're going to skip planning process for 192 Hayden Row. Correct, Mr. Kamalo?
Correct.
We're going to pass in the public hearing for street acceptance, and we're going to get right to the town meeting warrant. Mr. Kamalo, we have a town meeting warrant. Okay. We have lots of articles on here. We have 63 articles on here. We have gone through this in the past, and we had hoped that our next meeting we'd have, I think we called out about 10 articles where we were looking for some input as part of the process. But I think, again, specific to the emergency meeting rules, can we debate, discuss, get input on individual articles tonight, or do we just either vote to sign or not sign the warrant as it is?
Through the chair, it's the latter.
Yeah.
Where the board has to sign the town meeting warrant.
That is time sensitive.
Yes.
All right. But the deliberation of the articles in advance of town meeting for our position is not as time sensitive. That just needs to be before town meeting. We could actually do it if we really wanted to right there prior to it if we had to. But the signing of the warrant is the time sensitive matter. We've discussed this with town council, and that is the guidance that we received. Anybody have any questions about what question is before us tonight specific to the warrant? Mrs. Wright.
So, in other words, any of the suggested changes and things that we discussed at our last meeting, we will have to sign and approve what's here without any further input. There would be no room later to have input.
On the
if the changes were made. Like, I know some things have been changed since our last meeting, a couple of those articles.
Correct. In strictly the warrant, there can be no further changes.
Mm-hmm.
However, the board has the opportunity to insert changes when we draft the motions, so long as the language that is proposed for the changes is within the four corners identified in the town meeting warrant articles.
Mm-hmm. But that would be on town meeting floor?
No. It will be as we formulate the
motions document. In advance.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
All right. Understood.
Okay. Any other questions? So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to approve, for the Board of Selectmen to approve and sign the town, to sign the annual town meeting warrant for May 1st, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to sign the warrant. Mr. Kamalo, are you good with the motion?
Yes.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, it's unanimous and so carries. So we've got some signatures we got to do tonight. So that is the warrant item on the agenda. Liaison reports and invites. I guess it is somewhat time sensitive, not for liaison reports. We're going to skip that. Invites. Mr. Kamalo, anything on the invite side that's time sensitive?
Yes. The most important invite of the year is the holding of the Boston Marathon this coming Monday.
Yes.
And all board members are invited, perhaps we should say required.
Required is a pretty strong word.
Mm-hmm. Invited.
Required.
I think a lot of us
shows my defiance.
Yeah.
Required means I'm probably not going to be there. Invited means I'll be there.
Yes, we have the marathon on Monday. Absolutely.
Encourage is a good one. How's that?
Encourage is very well done.
Anything else?
No.
I haven't seen any come in. Anybody aware of anything on the invite side?
Nope.
Okay. Future board agenda, scratch that. Done with. You have nothing else for town manager's report?
Anything else?
And with that, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
In a second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye. We do have a bunch of warrants to sign, so please sit tight. Thank you all.
Thank you
for your patience tonight.
We don't have to initial every page.
Chief.